From a defabricated solar-powered garden shed in Rockland County, New York, USA, this is Stand Up with Pete Dominic. On today's episode, how to increase your swim time at your next trip to the beach by fleeing in terror from those bloodthirsty orcas. And now, the podcast host who would never go swimming in the ocean because he is afraid of jellyfish, Pete Dominic!
Well, partially true, Pico, partially true. I will not swim with jellyfish. I'm not going to lie to you. If I see jellyfish, I swim the other way, or I do not go in the ocean at all. I've not had this pleasure of being attacked by a jellyfish, but I know many of you have, and I hear it is no fun. It could be a day or vacation ruiner, so I will pass. But I do swim with the orcas, because they're totally friendly. Hello, my friends and family. Welcome to today's episode of Stand Up. I've got a very, very good conversation with David Rothkopf today. I also talked to Richard Reeves, but we had some technical issues, and so we're going to have to reschedule on that. But really, really interesting guy, the author of a new book of Boys and Men, Why the Modern Male is Struggling, Why It Matters, and What to Do About It. So disappointed I didn't get that. I only mention it because I previewed it yesterday. I'm not sure who was waiting with bated breath for that or anything, but I did want to say, really cool guy. Very much looking forward to taping an interview with him in the next couple of weeks. We had to reschedule, but very much in demand. Highly recommend his work. Came recommended from a couple listeners. By the way, I think my technical issue is that my 250-foot Ethernet cable that goes from inside my house all the way out to this shed may have finally crapped out after almost 3 years. As you may have noticed, at last week's Hangout, I was having issues. I had to move. And I've been having issues with my interviews, so going to have to replace that. Going to be a major repair shed tech issue. So we'll get that fixed ASAP. Thank you very much for joining me today. I hope that you will join me tonight because I'll be hosting the Hangout on a Wednesday night instead of Thursday. As a result of, on account of, it's the Stang Bang. It's the 18 high school buddies of mine getting together this weekend. Really looking forward to that. And I'm really looking forward to seeing you tonight. We are going to help our friend Vicky get a new job because she just lost her gig. And so we're going to talk about that. I'm really excited to always love to help folks out in our community. And so we'll talk a little bit about that and we'll see what else. Always a good time. If you're a subscriber, you should be getting an email with a link to tonight's Hangout. If not, let me know and I will hook you up. All right. Let's check in on the news from yesterday. What do we have here? Ashley Babbitt's mom pushes Antifa protester, smashes her megaphone at protest outside the D.C. jail. Oh, that poor woman. Lost her daughter, and now she's basically become her daughter. That is a tragic story right there. Joe Biden's sexual harassment or assault accuser, Tara Reid, has defected to Russia, claiming she feared being jailed or killed in the U.S. Well, the plot thickens on that. It was a weird one, right? Because when we say that we believe women, but maybe not the ones that are accusing the Democratic nominee for president, Joe Biden. That was a bit of a challenging issue for many of us. But at the same time, she was also very hard to believe based on a whole bunch of actual reporting. But it's interesting how that story seems to be concluding. Trump vowed yesterday to nullify part of the Constitution by executive order on day one of his second term when he said that he would get rid of the birthright citizenship part of the Constitution. Of course, he can't do that, or maybe he can. So it'd be great to make sure that he doesn't get elected. Checking in on Canada and the wildfires in Nova Scotia, the eastern coast of Pennsylvania forced more than 16,000 people to evacuate up there. Wow, that is crazy. It has been hot and dry here in the East Coast for weeks now, so I'm not surprised by that. Terrible news coming out of Canada. Here's some good news. Cardiologists hope a new genetic test is going to help identify most people most likely to have heart attacks before they have them. I like that a lot. So that's some good news. Let's see what else. Elizabeth Holmes, the disgraced Theranos entrepreneur, whose story I never followed, has reported to federal prison, begin her 11-year sentence. And speaking of criminals, one of the worst criminals of the century, the decade, I don't know, trial of the gunman who killed 11 people at Pittsburgh synagogue in 2018 in the deadliest anti-Semitic attack in the nation's history has begun. That trial has begun. The prosecutors are seeking the death penalty for the defendant there. I always felt like that story was kind of undercovered and underreported and not impactful enough that that happened. And I won't say the guy's name, but all of what he believed in and so on. So I hope to see him get justice. I am not a supporter of the death penalty, but in this dude's case, life in prison would be just fine with me. But the big news yesterday continues to be the debt ceiling negotiations. I talk a little bit about that with David Rothkopf, but the headlines as of late Tuesday night, the U.S. House is poised to vote on the urgently needed debt ceiling suspension. House Speaker and empty barrel of a human, Kevin McCarthy, confident that the debt vote will pass despite the hardline threat from his hard right conspiracist flank. But the House Rules Committee, very influential committee, voted 7-6 to approve the rules allowing debate in the full chamber. And if it passes the House, it will still head to the Senate. And then the measure needs congressional approval by June 5th when the Treasury Department could run out of funds to pay its debts for the first time in U.S. history. Now, that is, I think, next Tuesday, in case you're keeping watch on that. Both President Biden and Kevin McCarthy predicted they'll get enough votes to pass the 99-page bill into law before the deadline. The nonpartisan budget scorekeeper for Congress on Tuesday said the legislation would reduce spending from its current projections by $1.5 trillion over 10 years beginning next year. The CBO also said the measure, if enacted into law, would reduce interest on the public debt by $188 billion. Kevin McCarthy, for his part, saying the bill is the most conservative deal we've ever had, but conservative Republicans who sought far deeper spending reductions were not persuaded to that. So we'll see what happens. Maybe they're just making a lot of noise, banging pots. Could be smoking some pot, if you ask me. Huh? All right, well, that's all I've got for you on the news update. I'm not going to play sound of these people complaining, the Republicans complaining about it. You can go find that and listen to it if you want, but it's all going to be over pretty soon, I hope. So let's get to my conversation with David Rothkopf, who is so good on Twitter, keeping Twitter alive. DJ Rothkopf on Twitter. You can listen to him on Deep State Radio. You can get his new book, American Resistance, the inside story of how the deep state saved the nation. Check him out at therothkopfgroup.com. And let's do it right now with one of your favorites, my favorites, David Rothkopf.
Here he is, solid gold, your favorite, David Rothkopf. Welcome back. Thank you, Captain Reasonable, for joining me.
Captain Reasonable. Will you could we please speak to my children about this?
I would like to speak to your children about anything. Maybe you're too reasonable. You see a lot of nuance in things, and you have experience working in government. And I feel like that helps you understand how things realistically can or cannot happen, which is why your belief is the 14th Amendment was not a magic wand that could have been waved. Fair to say?
I think the 14th Amendment is absolutely clear. I think the president has an obligation to pay our debts. I think the country, everybody is sworn an oath to the Constitution does. But that doesn't mean everybody agrees. And so that means that if the president were to, he doesn't have to invoke it. He could just say, you know, this is me under my constitutional responsibility. Somebody will challenge it and it'll go to the courts. Well, what would that do to world markets? Well, they were trying to figure out, you know, what the brains trust we have at SCOTUS would do on this kind of thing, since they don't seem to care about, you know, stare decisis, which is to say precedent. They don't seem to care about logic. They're super ideological. You know, they're nuts on the Second Amendment. Why would they be any more reasonable about the 14th Amendment? And so, you know, the president was explicit. At some point, this is something we should explore, but not when the world markets are holding their breath and the potential consequences are millions of people out of work, markets crashing, etc. He came to the conclusion that he could strike a deal that would be ultimately the best budget deal that he could get with a Republican House, no matter when he discussed it, you know, and that's what he's gotten. You know, that's what he's gotten. He's got the best deal. He preserves essentially all of his prior budgetary priorities. There are a few minor adjustments at the sides. This is the deal he would have gotten in October if the Republicans had been sane and, you know, followed things via the normal appropriations process. And, I think he deserves a lot of credit for it. Although I also say, you know, in this context of nuance, you know, the president yesterday was asked, well, you know, why don't you thump your chest about this? I'm paraphrasing. And it's like, well, that isn't going to help get this passed. Right. It's going to produce Republican backlash, you know, and he's a grown up. He's like, I got the best deal I could. I think I got the best deal that we could get for the country. And now I'm going to do what I need to do to make sure that deal gets passed, including not behaving like a complete child and dancing on my opposition before the votes are counted.
Yeah, we want so badly for our leaders, especially in this atmosphere, to gloat, to thump their chest, to tout their accomplishments. But that's ego, and it's not necessarily pragmatic to get things done. Is that fair?
Yeah, I think that's fair. And then there's a whole other group of people who, you know, are essentially indulging themselves in magical thinking because there's no cost for them in doing so. They can go on Twitter and say, oh, no, the president should definitely have increased taxes to the super rich. Or, oh, no, the president should definitely not have given one inch in terms of work requirements. Or, oh, no, the you know, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, that is completely unreasonable in the context of the Republicans controlling the House, which they do. And if people want to have a different kind of experience with the Congress, they need a different Congress. So go elect Democrats. Have Democrats in a substantial majority in both houses. It's like the people are like, well, we should have definitely gotten the debt ceiling done last year before the Congress changed. Well, folks, Joe Manchin and Kristen Sinema have said they're not going to go along with this stuff. So it wouldn't have happened, even if they could have gotten it done under a reconciliation agreement. And it certainly wouldn't have happened if they required 60 votes. So, you know, yeah, it would be better, but we don't get everything that we want in life. You know, we get as much as we can. And this is Joe Biden's kind of singular genius. He reads it, he sees what he can get, and then he gets it. And every single time, whether it was the American Rescue Plan after COVID, bipartisan infrastructure deal, the Inflation Reduction Act, the Chips and Science Act, the 300 or so bipartisan bills that he has signed, and this, people have underestimated him. They said, oh, you can't do that. And people have howled on either side. And he has the most accomplishments of any president after 2.5 years, certainly since Lyndon Johnson.
Yeah, you have a very popular thread, like many of your threads that you write. It's gone viral on Twitter, still. Dave Rothkopf is keeping Twitter alive single-handedly with his threads. You write, stealthily without proportionate recognition, Joe Biden is not just having a good presidency, he's having one of his historic and its concrete achievements and successes. The fair and balanced types in the media won't characterize it fairly because to do so would feel biased. The opposition won't cover it because it's not in their interest to tell the truth. That's why they never do. Editors and producers will shy away from it because positive stories don't sell like conflict does. Consequently, most of the media won't present simple facts, but I will, and you are, and that's why I want to talk with you about it. I mean, who are you talking about, or what types of media are you talking about that won't characterize the concrete achievements and successes? Because certainly it's not going to get high ratings, those segments, those networks.
But we know the examples of all of these things, right? We saw Chris Licht, the new honcho at CNN, get out there and say, well, I want to tell both sides. But what are both sides of this is the biggest infrastructure bill since Eisenhower? You know, what are both sides of this is the biggest green vest package in American history? What are both sides of there were more jobs created in the past 2.5 years than ever in the first 2.5 years of any president? What are both sides of NATO is bigger, NATO is stronger, Putin is on the ropes, Ukraine is supported? What are both sides of he finally got around to doing the pivot to Asia? I could go through this long list. There aren't both sides to facts. The job of journalists is not to say both sides. The job of journalists is to report the truth. But the chrysalids don't think that's it, because if you report the truth and it pisses off half the audience, then they won't come to you. They will go someplace else that will offer them an alternative truth. That gets us to the next group, the people who just will lie, right? Fox will lie. OANN will lie. Breitbart will lie. You know, the whole right-wing media machine will just lie. So they're not going to tell the truth because it's not in their interest and they don't give a damn about the truth. And then, you know, the final group, you know, there are others who are just saying, well, I need to have a little bit of conflict, because all cable TV or podcasts or other kinds of things need to be cage match. You know, that's what gets, right. You know, that's what gets eyeballs. And so we're going to get some idiot, you know, some ex Trump administration official, some former senator, some wing nut to go in, and they're going to talk, you know, complete nonsense for half of it, all the coverage, because again, it, you know, it's that creates that drama. And, yeah. You know, so, you know, some of these people are pretty well-intentioned. They just don't end up in the right place.
Wow. You really starting to sound like David Rothkopf, if you ask me.
You know, I have the woke mind virus. I do.
You seem like
proud of it.
You're ill with the woke mind virus.
I love it. And I, you know, because I remember back in the day, there were people who said caring about other people, respecting other people, trying to take care of those most in need, trying to rectify the wrongs that exist within our society is what we should do. You know, like other like Jewish guys like me, like Jesus, right?
And, I was going to say, you're talking about Jesus?
Yeah. And it's like, you know, all these so-called evangelical Christians or all these so-called people who are supporting values are against the founding values of the religion that they purport to be defending, because they don't actually care about that.
There's this weird thing happening. I don't know if you've seen this, and maybe I'm missing it. I think I got it. I think I understand it. The Christian right has been increasingly inclusive of minorities in their churches, including, you know, LDS Mormons since, you know, what, a few years back, they started letting black people come in. Churches know that they need to have ethnic diversity. Hey, as long as you're Christian, we're okay with you, as long as you support our Christian beliefs. And I don't know if you saw this, but like Chick-fil-A, which is owned and operated by a Christian family, they close on Sunday. They were anti-gay. They are doing great because their chicken is delicious. But apparently now some on the right are saying that Chick-fil-A has gone woke because they're inclusive. They support diversity and inclusion. And what I think what we're seeing is that the white Christian nationalists don't love that these other Christians, which are by every definition very conservative, often anti-gay, aren't necessarily anti-brown and black or even immigrant. And so they're being cast off. These organizations, individuals, and even churches we thought were extreme, conservative extreme, they are being called woke, including some candidates. Are you seeing some of that?
Well, of course, we're all seeing it everywhere around us. You know, one of the things that I find most, you know, bizarre is that across the whole spectrum of the GOP, including some of the reasonable guys who know how to put on a suit, or the reasonable women who know how to, you know, bathe and, you know, show up on MSNBC and other networks, you know, they're like, well, we are against the DEI movement. We are against the institutional DEI structures. And you go, well, the first time I heard it, I was like, DEI, this is some sort of alcohol impairment. And I was like, you know, I looked it up and it's like diversity, equity, and inclusion. And it's like, wait a minute. You are against equity? I mean, seriously? You're against inclusion? You're against diversity? How can you be offended by the effort to treat all human beings as though they had the same rights and deserved the same respect?
They would tell you that's not what it is. It's giving minorities advantages. At my school board meeting 2 years ago, a guy said, DEI is simply code for CRT. And I went up and said, do you know what either of those are acronyms for? And he ran out. But,
well, CRT, I know, is cathode ray tube.
That's right.
Which used to be, you know, a big thing in the computing industry.
Right. That's right.
Because they're probably more cathode ray tubes in our education system than there are people teaching critical race theory. Which doesn't actually exist. You know, it's not a thing that's taught in elementary schools. But, you know, look at what they object to when they take action on behalf of getting rid of critical race theory. What is it there? They object to teaching about slavery. They object to questioning whether it's a good thing that the founders of this country owned slaves. They object to, you know, poems that speak to equality, like the Amanda Gorman poems that have been, you know, blocked in some Florida school districts. They're not talking about critical race theory. They're talking about equity. They oppose equity. They oppose treating people with respect and decency. And the reason they do is that their base is a bunch of scared white Christian males who thought they ran the United States of America and who are on the cusp of no longer doing so because they're going to be in the super minority around this country. And this period we're going through, and it's going to last for another couple decades. Census Bureau says 2043 is when we become a minority majority country. This period is their last howl in search of relevance.
I went to Target the other day and I came home and drank a Bud Light and I had sex with three men that afternoon.
First of all, Bud Light will make you do that.
Yeah.
And Target, of course, I'm sure you went into the rainbow section at Target and, took your first steps towards transitioning.
Yes.
Because that happens when you go to a department store. The people have lost their freaking minds. That's just it, you know. And this is, again, this is my problem with fair and balanced media coverage. How do you treat that as though that were politics as usual, legitimate position? No, that's racism. That's sexism. That's misogyny. That's craziness. You need to say, this is crazy. You know, that's not biased reporting. That's reporting the fact. We got a serious problem. I just saw a story literally minutes before I came on your August program where Trump, there's a story knocking around today. It says Trump wants the names of all the people in the DOJ and the FBI who've been after his butt so that he can fire them all immediately. He also wants to, you know, suspend the Constitution and X, Y, and Z.
Yep.
And some reporter for some big major publication was like, well, we can expect to see a lot more of this in a second Trump term. And it's like, well, can we really? We can see him try to do this, but he doesn't actually get to do it. You know, he doesn't get to suspend the Constitution. He said he wanted to get rid of birthright citizenship.
Right.
Which is called for in the words of the Constitution of the United States. Donald Trump can't wave his magic wand and eliminate that by fiat. Saying that he could is a lie, and raises the hopes of the lunatics who follow him.
Do you think, getting back to the debt ceiling deal, which we're talking on Tuesday afternoons, yet to be voted on, but what you're seeing is the Freedom Caucus, the far right insurrectionist types, the Chip Roy, Scott Perry, Boebert, they're all heavily critical of Kevin McCarthy, even questioning whether or not they're going to, you know, call him to the carpet, and because they can. Everybody knows what I'm talking about. With the one vote, they can make him not speaker anymore. It seems like there's only a dozen or so of them that might be that outraged and voting. And one conclusion was, if McCarthy gets away with this, does that temper the crazies? Because they don't seem to have that many numbers that are going to be that critical. They're being that way today. They're certainly heavily critical of McCarthy. How do you think this shakes out within the Republican House caucus, within them? I mean, Kevin McCarthy is Paul Ryan, is John Boehner. They all would be more moderate to a certain extent if they didn't have these huge amount of crazy people dragging them off a cliff.
Yeah, well, first of all, I think Kevin McCarthy makes John Boehner look like Daniel Webster.
Okay.
I mean, Kevin McCarthy is a nut himself.
Yeah.
He has supported the insurrection. First he didn't, then he did. You know, he was the first one to go and kiss Trump's shoes, et cetera.
He's just hollow. He's like Lindsey Graham. He just is a hollow, just pursuit of power, no principle.
Exactly. Yeah. And it is that hollow pursuit of power in which we should take some hope, because the nut jobs don't have enough votes to control the House and they don't want it. It is much better to be Ronnie Jackson. I mean, Ronnie Jackson, man.
He's the former White House doctor, right? That guy?
I know. What a fucking freak show he is. But on a regular basis, he's a freak show.
Yeah.
It's much better to have no responsibility and to be able to say whatever you want and to be able to raise money against that and to keep your job and to go to the rubber chicken dinners of the nut jobs on the right and think you're important than it is to actually have to govern. Because then they'd have to get, all of the people in their party to agree on their lunatic ideas,
right,
which they can't do. Then they would start to lose, and that would be a problem for them. So it's better for them to be on the outside of the tent pissing in than it is the other way around. McCarthy, on the other hand, in order to stay in power, has to get some stuff through. Now, the way it looks is, and the House Rules Committee is, heavily weighted towards the Republicans in a way that shouldn't really be legal. But it just takes a couple of the Republicans to say, yeah, we're going to put this through from that right wing group for it to happen. And I think looks like Massey, who's one of these, Christmas card AR-15 guys, may let this thing pass through the Rules Committee. When it passes through the Rules Committee, it goes from a world completely controlled by Republicans into one where if you got a bunch of Democrats, you can actually get stuff done.
Yep.
And that's what's going to happen, I think. And I think this thing is going to pass. And I don't think, anybody who's listening to your show who is a Democrat should gloat about this until it actually passes. But, I do think that what's going to happen is this is going to pass. And, Biden will have another legislative achievement.
Sounds like Thomas Massey's at your house.
There is somebody howling at the moon at my house, but I think, unfortunately, it's Grizzly, the big orange dog.
What about this Nancy Mace tweeting today? Just ridiculously childish, unprofessional, ageist comment about the president of the United States not being able to find his pants.
Everybody's not being able to put his put his pants on or whatever.
Something,
it was.
Whatever.
Yeah.
What?
But I think that goes back to the earlier point. Nancy Mace is like a favorite of the CNNs of this
right
world, because they go, well, here's Nancy Mace. She's a reasonable Republican, but she's not. She is a freak show Republican. She just is able to express herself without foaming at the mouth. And so, you know, they'll say, well, that's good. You know, that sounds like normal political debate. But they can say everything they want, right? They can say everything they want. Joe Biden has achieved more in 2.5 years than any of his predecessors since Johnson and maybe since Roosevelt. More than Trump, who got one big tax bill through. More than Obama, who got health care reform and precious little else through. More than George W. Bush, known for starting the, you know, worst, most inequitable, you know, war in our history. He, you know, more than Clinton, more than George H.W. Bush, more than Reagan, Carter, Ford, Nixon, more than all of them. You know, if the right wing wants to say he's a doddering old fool, how does that reflect on them?
Yeah, you know, as you're talking about earlier, I was thinking about the healthcare, Obamacare repeal fight within the Republican House caucus when Trump was president. It was always bluster. It was always, we will repeal and we'll replace it with something better that'll create more access, better quality, more affordability in healthcare. They themselves never had the votes. It was always just
talk. They didn't have the votes for Trump's friggin' wall, right? I think they got, you know, as Caitlin Collins pointed out during that Trump pep rally that she co-hosted, not her fault, but it was, that's what it turned out to be. I think they got 53 miles of new wall done. This is what Trump ran. This is the first thing he said.
Yeah.
They didn't get that done. They didn't get anything done. And I think that ultimately history will look back at this, tune out the noise, see what actually happened. It's going to reflect very well on Biden. But it's not just history. Americans are not as stupid as these people think they are. And what happened in 2020, what happened in 2022, Biden won. The Republicans didn't perform. The extremist Republicans in 2022 got creamed. And, the Democrats almost held the House. They continued to hold the Senate. I think there's a very good chance that in 2024, because they're hammering home insane abortion laws, book banning, insane gun laws, laws in terms of voter repression that are clearly unconscionable efforts to keep the poor people of color and so forth from voting. I think that the Democrats might not just eke out a win. I think they might hammer a stake through MAGA's heart and do the one thing that's going to stop Trump, DeSantis, and all these Freedom Caucus nutjobs. And that's say, it's a political loser, folks. What you want is a political loser. And we might, if that happens, it's going to be because Joe Biden's secret power is tuning out the bullshit and getting shit done.
You know, one other thing that could be instrumental, stands in the way, is Russia and Vladimir Putin. Your most recent piece at the Daily Beast is really important. Trump and Putin are in deep trouble and need each other more than ever. Real quick, before we get to that, did you think in February of 2022, when Russia invaded Ukraine, that we would ever see a day like we did yesterday where there were invasions, there were attacks in Moscow, there were kamikaze drones in Moscow? I mean, my, how things have changed in that conflict, to the conflict first and then to Trump and Putin needing each other.
But I'm not going to comment on the drones because I don't know enough about who sent the drones, okay, and whether they were real or whether they were false flag operation or what they were. Oh, right. Okay. I don't know.
Fair.
But clearly nobody thought in February of 2022 that we would be at a point where Putin, according to a report yesterday, has lost 2,000 tanks, where he's effectively had to deploy his entire conventional military to Ukraine, where he has not achieved any significant military goals, where if Ukraine launches an offensive, as is expected, it can be expected that Russia will lose some ground, where apparently in the fight for Bakhmut alone, a small non-strategic city, Russia had 100 1,000 casualties, according to Joe Biden. Russia has done appallingly badly. And there is every reason to believe, especially now with Ukraine getting more advanced weapon systems, likely to have F-16s in a few months. Even yesterday, there was one red line weapon system that the U.S. said, under no circumstances can we give this to Ukraine. It's something called ATACMS, A-T-A-C-M-S, which is a long-range missile system, which could actually strike inside parts of Russia. And yesterday, President Biden said they were considering it.
Wow. Trump and Putin need each other? How so?
Well, look, I mean, Trump and Putin wanted each other in 2016 because Putin thought Trump would stir things up and might weaken the United States. And Trump wanted to win. And so he was happy to have anybody help him win. Fast forward to 2024. The only way Trump's going to stay out of jail, not keep getting hit with giant fines, not have his name completely discredited in the courts, is if he becomes president and he can stop that and pardon himself,
right?
Pardon the people around him. It's existential for Donald Trump to want to be president. So he wants all the help he can get because it's essential. The only way Vladimir Putin can have a win in Ukraine is if the leadership in the United States changes. If he does not get a win in Ukraine and this grinds on or the losses tally up, it's also existential for him. So we've gone from in 2016, where they wanted each other, to in 2024, where they desperately need each other. And we know neither of them cares about the rules. Neither of them cares that, you know, Russia is a U.S. enemy. Neither of them cares about perceptions of corruption. They just do what they need to do to survive. And so I would expect that Russian interference in the election, Russian support for Trump, Trump embrace of Russian support, they're seeking third party support to support the, you know, advance their other objectives, is going to be off the charts. And, you know, we've seen where that went in the past. And the last thing I would add is, you know, you had the Durham report, which was just completely empty, came up with nothing, didn't do any of the things that it was set up to do. But the Republicans are using it to say, see, Trump Russia was a hoax. Well, that's super dangerous, not just because it's a lie. They lie all the time. It's super dangerous because right now the risk of Trump Russia Act Two is so much greater than the risk was of Act One.
Yeah, as you laid out in that piece and just now in these comments, it's so much greater for so many different reasons. Well, I guess it remains to be seen. I mean, could he even pardon himself if he got reelected? Could he run from prison? There's so many questions that I feel like we'll learn the answers to.
But the answer is, yes, he can run from prison. And yes, he probably can pardon himself. And yes, he can definitely pardon the January Sixers. But I've got another question. You know, you can answer this question.
Probably not.
How many of the Republicans, Ron DeSantis, Mike Pence, Nikki Haley, et cetera, would pardon Trump if they got elected?
Probably all of them.
Probably all of them.
It would be so politically advantageous for them to win over his voters. If they win the election, they're going to want to get his supporters, and that's all they need to do is give him the old, yeah.
And maybe they let some of the January Sixers through. And what does that do? I mean, they don't much like democracy to begin with. They certainly don't show any respect for the Constitution to begin with. But if they start pardoning this army and it knows that its survival is dependent on the Republicans being in power, if they let Trump off the hook and the message gets sent to the world that you can lead an insurrection in the United States, steal classified documents, defraud the public, and so long as the party in power has your back, you can do so with impunity, we're fucked as a democracy.
Have you given any thought to Joe Manchin running for president and getting like 5 to 9% of the vote and putting Trump back in office?
Yeah, well, you know, obviously you've given it thought because 5 to 9 wasn't random. There was just a poll which said he would get 9%. And something like 5% or the majority of it would come from Democrats and not from Republicans. And it would make it so that Trump or whoever the Republican would win. So, of course, I've given thought. First of all, I think Manchin is despicable. I think he has been, you know, terrible for the Democrats in many, many ways. Yeah. And there's no way you're going to fix the situation in West Virginia. So you need a bigger majority to deal with somebody like him. But this whole Manchin, this whole movement, no labels, which once a long time ago was, hey, let's all, you know, join hands and set aside partisanship and, you know, create a bigger center, you know, is now clearly an effort to weaken whoever the Democratic candidate is, yep, and get Trump elected. And it has to be seen as such. You know, it's going to say, oh, we hate partisanship and, but, you know, let's sing Kumbaya together. And essentially what they're saying is we want to put democracy in the United States at further risk.
And what do you think the likelihood of that is, whether it be Manchin or somebody else in that lane running and legitimately drawing?
I think the likelihood is that they'll test the waters a little bit and see if they can pick up anything. My guess is they'll probably fritter out a little bit. I do think, and I'd be very interested to see whether there is a sort of similar move on the Republican side with Liz Cheney. To peel off some of the Republicans who are nauseated by the far right. I think, you know, given the margins in the last few elections, we can't be complacent about this. These things could tip the results. And by the way, No Labels, for example, knows that this really only matters in a few states. And it just matters in a few states where they can tip the results over to Trump. And so it doesn't, you know, they don't have to do it coast to coast. It's very hard to do coast to coast to have a third party. You have to be registered in all 50 states and so on and so forth. It's very tough. But they do know that, you know, they could create mayhem in the Wisconsins of this world or the Georgias or the, you know, Arizonas or Nevadas of this world. Which are swing states. And I think that's their game, and that's what we have to be wary of.
We mustn't let them.
Well, we mustn't let their bullshit work.
Right.
And we must make an intensive effort to send the message to independent voters, Democrats who don't vote or who are, you know, who typically sit on their hands, that you must get out there, not just to let Joe Biden finish the job, but because this election is binary. Either somebody who supports democracy will win or somebody who opposes democracy will win. Somebody who supports basic freedoms, women's right to control her own body, the ability of everybody to vote, the ability of a child to go to school without being feared that they're going to be gunned down, you know, is on one side, and people who oppose those freedoms and want to strip them away and want to go to the next step and say, we will decide who you can marry. We will decide, you know, whether you can have a birth control pill. You know, they want to go that next step. You know, this is a black and white choice. And that's one of the, you know, if I may, just for 30 seconds more, one of the things that happens when I go out and I write something saying, I wrote an article in the Daily Beast on Friday of last week saying, you know, Joe Biden is really kind of a legislative master, you know, and he's got this great track record. And a lot of people are like, well, why are you kissing the president's ass? And this wasn't perfect and, you know, and so forth. And I'm like, yeah, I get it that it's not perfect, but it's way better than we expected on the one hand.
Yep.
And on the other hand, it's not the issue. The issue is, do you want this country to continue to be a democracy or not? Mm. And for me, you know, I am a one issue voter. And there is one party that's pro-democracy, and there is one party that's anti-democracy. And I don't think I or anybody else can risk taking a chunk, a one-vote chunk, 100-vote chunk, 100,000-vote chunk, a million-vote chunk, out of the potential support for the pro-democracy party. Because if the other ones get into power, you're going to watch these institutions be gutted, perverted, twisted. And all of a sudden, there are many things which you have taken for granted about the United States that'll be gone, and they won't come back.
Right.
Because they won't let there be fair elections anymore. So you gotta quibble with Joe Biden. That's great. Keep it to your fucking self. Focus on the real stakes here. And win big, and then give him a hard time. You know, hold it for 18 months. Get 55% of the vote. Get substantial margins in the Senate and House. And then you want to give Joe Biden a hard time when our country isn't at imminent risk of failing. You know, the American idea is not at imminent risk of failing. Fine. Do it then. Not now. We don't have the luxury.
Yeah, I fully agree that we so many progressives and Democrats forever thinking the perfect is the enemy of the good and wanting this zero sum game, which is exactly what the other side thinks. And we just can't be that. And it's not mature, and it's not how things have ever worked and will ever work, as hard as that is to accept. Where are you on child labor laws, David? For, against, what, by the way?
What, I mean, what are you
before
talking
I let
about?
You go, before I let you go, I mean, where are you? Before,
I mean, shouldn't, I mean, that's going to be a joke, right?
I saw North Dakota there. No, there's the, you know, this right wing movement to loosen all the child, a lot of child labor laws. Have you not been paying attention to these?
No, I have. But I mean, of course there should be child labor.
Oh,
laws.
You think there should be?
Yeah, of course we should take care of children. We shouldn't have them working in the mines. We shouldn't have them all sort of turn into, you know, Oliver Twist and running around in our streets. You know, I mean, let's, you know, get a grip. They are interested in undoing 100 years of progress in the United States and launching us back to the middle of the 19th century or worse. And, you know, I mean, you know, we just can't let it happen. But we know this. If they eke out a win, they will find a way to do it,
yeah,
even though the majority of Americans don't believe it. And if you don't think that can happen, then go back to the fact that 90% of Americans support background checks.
Yep.
More than 2/3 of all Americans support a fairly significant number of gun control laws. More than 2/3 support healthcare reform. More than 2/3 support educational reform. More than 2/3 support a more activist climate laws. And more than 2/3 support essentially the agenda that the United States Supreme Court opposes. And they're not being listened to. The Supreme Court just last week said, hey, you know, wetlands, that's not part of our water system. And the EPA can't regulate that. And it's like, are you friggin' kidding me? That, you know, these people who are against judicial activism have now said, nope, we're in charge. We're in charge. We're going to make our decisions, you know, purely based on, you know, our gut feelings and without any regard for the law or the interests of the United States. So we are already in territory where the will of the supermajority in the United States is being trampled on by an overempowered minority, and they want to take that further.
Well said. Thank you very much, sir. Much appreciated. You're the best. Keep up the good work. Never die, Rothkopf.
Well, thanks. You shouldn't die either.
I'm less important, but I appreciate that nonetheless.
You know, you shouldn't, whatever you do in your life, try not to be the Boston Celtics.
Well said. I mean, well, as long as I don't cheat, I should be okay.
Well, it's so long as you don't choke in the way, the horrible, embarrassing, humiliating, characterless way they choked.
Well, I mean, they won 3 games in a row. I mean, that was pretty impressive. And then they choked.
Well, yeah, they, first of all, the third of those 3 games, they almost lost.
I didn't see. Yeah. I was busy watching college lacrosse. That's how wide I am.
Watching sort of the worst of young white males is just what I would imagine you'd be doing at
even the announcers are that bad. This is really cheesy, but I love the game. What can I tell you?
No, lacrosse is a good game, but I grew up in, but a few years ago, I lived in a part of Bethesda, and there was a big private school nearby.
Yeah.
Where their lacrosse boys were doing horrible things to young ladies.
It's more than just a stereotype, unfortunately, is my feeling. It's somewhat endemic and real problematic. But the game, invented by Native Americans, the game itself.
Yeah, although I don't think any of these rich white boys would want to play the game that was invented by Native Americans.
That's true. That would be a different.
Because I think that took place where they had to run across the countryside.
They did.
And people died.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah. No, you're right about that. It's evolved a little bit. All right. Thank you very much, sir. Excellent as always. I appreciate you.
Likewise.
All right. There he goes, everybody. David Rothkopf, always great to have him on the show. Much appreciated. And go follow him on Twitter. Let him know that you heard him here on the program. And let me know that you heard the program today, what you like, what you don't like, what I can do better, more of, less of. StandUpWithPete@gmail.com. Hope to see you at tonight's hangout. And I'm going to leave you on a quote sent to me by the great Matt Carlson. Matty C, going out on tour. And you can follow him and support him at his Substack, whatamimaking.substack.com. He sent me this quote from Voltaire. Quote, appreciation is a wonderful thing. It makes what is excellent in others belong to us as well. Oh, all right. Thank you, Voltaire. Thank you, Matty C. And I hope to see you all tonight. Bye-bye. Boy, you better stand up. Stand up. Well, there's a whole lot more of us who know us right. They'll keep right on ignoring us if we keep sitting tight. We got to open up the window to let in some light. You got to stand up. That's right. You got to rise up. You got to stand up. You got to stare the devil straight in the eye. Off of your butt, down off of your fence. And even if it ain't a very friendly audience, well, they'll begin to listen when you start making sense. And you stand up, stand up. No need to point your rifle to defend your town. Just stand up, stand up. You know they can't deny you what you're laying down. Boy, you better stand up. Face of every color, yellow, black, red, and brown. She's the place where every lost child will finally be found. There's only one thing to do before we stand our ground, and that's stand up, stand up. Well, the founding fathers saw a land for all. They had to stand up,
they had to stand up.
They had a keen imagination for a crystal ball, drawing all the plans of
stand up.
But all they had to they were in with other causes for laws, and since they weren't even sin, they knew that change was gonna come before the change could begin. They had to stand up. All right, they had to stand up. We got to stand up. We got to look the devil square in the eye. We gotta let him know it's his time to go and make it clear when all we hear is a lie. See him flee the scene of that experiment. If you stand up,
stand
all right, up. We got to speak up, we got to reach up, and raise your voice in every way you know how. Don't be toes up, you got to show up. Ain't no better time to do it but now. No need to pledge allegiance to no wanton tribe. Rise up, show obedience to the voice inside. And listen well and it'll tell you not to run and hide. It says stand up.